Welcome to the Osmosis Daily Report on the coronavirus pandemic. I'm Dr. Rishi Desai. I'm the Chief Medical Officer at Osmosis. I'm also a pediatric infectious disease physician, and I used to work in the Division of Viral Diseases at the CDC doing viral research. Today we're going to talk about trusting antibody testing. To start us out, there was a report from the WHO about immunity passports, and in the very first paragraph of the report, there's this sentence that the news media has really picked up on. They write, quote, "There is currently no evidence that people who have recovered from COVID-19 and have antibodies are protected from a second infection." Now, I think that's a problematic statement for a few reasons. Maybe they meant that we haven't had human challenge studies where we infect people purposefully after they've had natural immunity to see if they don't get the infection again. Or maybe they meant that we haven't followed people that have had natural immunity over time to see if they have lower rates of reinfection versus someone that's never had the infection before. And if that's what they mean by no evidence, that's technically true because we haven't given people purposefully the infection to see if their antibodies are able to ward it off. We also haven't followed people over time. It would take far too long, and we haven't had that much time yet, to see if having the infection once really does, in a very controlled setting, prevent you from getting reinfection versus someone else. But let me be clear, that does not mean that we have no evidence. In fact, we have plenty of evidence that the immune response to an infection is protective and antibodies are protective against getting the infection again. Let me explain. Let's start with basic immunology and how all of these vaccines work when they're targeted towards a virus. What happens in most situations is you get an antibody response, and as you can see from this picture, the antibody basically helps your natural killer cells, among many other kind of mechanisms, this is one, to basically destroy virally infected cells. That's very, very basic immunology. And in fact, many vaccines are based on this very fundamental truth. Now here's a second data point with macaques, where they basically gave them COVID-19 and then tried to reinfect them, and here's what they found. Their key conclusion is that from this study of monkeys, reinfection could not occur if the monkeys had neutralizing antibody. Again, in monkeys, we've proven now, based on these kinds of tiny, tiny trials, that having antibody helps. Here's another study, also in macaques, where instead of giving the macaques an infection, they gave the macaques the vaccine. And then they tried to see if the vaccine would prevent the monkeys from getting sick. And here's their key finding. They say these antibodies potentially neutralize 10 representatives of SARS-CoV-2 strains, indicating broad neutralizing ability against the strains circulating worldwide. So not just one strain, but multiple strains of the virus. So again, we're seeing that antibodies help, this time antibodies that came from the vaccine versus natural infection. So I hope nobody walks away from reading this WHO statement thinking that immunity to COVID-19 is not protective. In fact, I believe all the evidence points to the fact that it is protective. But let's read further in this statement, because I think that the key point they're making is a little bit further down. Here they write, "Lab tests that detect antibodies in people need further validation to determine accuracy and reliability." Again, the problem is not in the immune system. We know the immune system works to defend you against virus. The real problem they're citing in the WHO paper is that the lab tests are not as trustworthy yet because they haven't been validated. And here's their key worry. They think that if a lab test tells a person that they're immune and the person believes the lab test, that they might go out and do things that public health officials don't recommend, and that you might get more cases of disease as a result. So that's what they're worried about. They're worried about the lab test being valid and correct, not really that your immune system doesn't work against viruses. We know, again, that's not the case. So let's talk briefly about lab testing and whether we know if it works. Let's start with the FDA, which has a page about emergency use authorizations. And if you scroll down, what you see is that there are 7 that have been approved for serology. A total of 7 from April 24th. You can see 3 up here and then 3 more here, and one final one, Celex, down here on April 1st. So April 1st to April 24th, a total of 7 have been approved by the FDA. But we know there are many, many other serological tests out there that are just waiting for approval, and so there's a huge logjam here. Now, going back to the question from the WHO, what evidence do we know that these tests work? Well, let's look at this paper called Test Performance Evaluation of SARS-CoV-2 Serological Assays. It literally is answering the question that we're posing here. And what they did was awesome. They basically took 12 test assays out there, not the FDA-approved ones, but other ones, and they ran them against a set of controls from patients. Some patients that had known COVID-19 and some that definitely did not have COVID-19. And they wanted to see how the results would vary between the tests. And the data is laid out beautifully. They have percent positive or sensitivity at the top. They have specificity at the bottom. So let's go one by one. In terms of percent positive, you want that number, of course, to be 100%. You don't want to miss people that have COVID-19. So looking across all these different studies or tests, which one performed well? Well, first things first, let's look at the fact that they have days since onset, meaning they checked how the assay performed given more time of disease. So if a person's only had the illness for 5 days versus 10 versus 15, overall the tests were able to catch a person having immunity when a person had it for longer. So you can see overall the trend is that if you let people have a disease for longer, you're able to detect immunity more effectively. Not always true in every exact case. You might see some exceptions here on the table, but generally that was the trend. So combining IgG or IgM, a positive on either, and looking at just 20 days or more of having illness, you can see that only one test actually captured everybody. That was the test from BioPerfectus. All of the other tests had some misses. And the range was between 81 and 100% sensitivity, which actually, to put in perspective, is pretty good when you compare that to RT-PCR. Now on the other side, you've got specificity. In other words, how often are you telling someone that they're immune and you're certain that they actually are versus you're telling them that they're immune and in fact, they don't have immunity. And this goes to the core issue brought up by the WHO. And on this scale, for specificity, the best test, the only one that got 100%, was SureBio. All the other ones had kind of a performance between 84% and 100%. So again, the specificity wasn't actually bad when you compare it to some other tests that are out there, but it wasn't 100% across the board. Now, this is great data, but the problem is this only captures 12 assays, and what we need is something that's done nationally across all of the different assays that are out there, and that study needs to get out there as quickly as possible so we can figure out what to trust and what not to trust. So bottom line, we need more testing so that we can do more studies like this one to figure out what to believe and what the cutoffs ought to be for granting immune certificates if that's the road that countries take, which likely will be something that many countries will do, and some have already done. So thanks for tuning in. Hit the red subscribe button or the bell icon to get daily updates. Also check out osmosis.org/COVID-19 for all of our free resources. Remember to do your part to raise the line and flatten the curve. We're all in this together.